in my book, I interview this writer, this young Chinese writer who has quit her job, and she lives with her parents, she pretends she's going to the office. She goes to this little writing space. I don't know where she gets her money from, but she goes to this little writing space and she writes these novels, and then she goes home at 5, and her parents didn't know she was writing, she didn't know she'd quit her job, nothing. I was like, oh my goodness, that's crazy. And I was like, oh, I do the exact same thing.
I am pleased to welcome author and multimedia storyteller Val Wang. Val was raised in a strict Chinese-American household in the suburbs of Washington, D.C. She got good grades, took piano lessons, and performed in a Chinese dance troupe. Then, in 1998, in an act of rebellion, she moved to China, the country her parents had fled 40 years earlier. Her memoir, Beijing Bastard, Into the Wilds of Changing China, is about that move and discovering a city rebelling against its roots, just as she was finding her own identity.
You know, when people think of a Chinese American writing a memoir about China, you often think, oh, it's a return to the roots story. You know, you went back to find out about your past, find out about who you come from. And really the story is the opposite. It really began as a form of rebellion for my family. And you know, if I wanted to rebel for my family, probably going to China was not the right place to go. But I really wanted to get far, physically very far away from them, and you can't pretty much get farther. I grew up in D.C. You can't get farther than China without kind of coming back around the other side of the globe. So I went to get away from my family, but you know, in the process did end up connecting with my family's history and reconnecting with my family in ways that were very unexpected to me. So it kind of has two of these stories in the memoir, that rebellion, but also a coming back or a reconciliation with my family. So in the memoir chronicles 5 years I spent in the city right after college, and I worked as a journalist there, but I was just nurturing this secret desire to be a documentary maker and an artist. So this is partly a memoir, it's partly a coming of age memoir, partly but my personal coming of age and what I went through, but it's also really a coming of age of the city, which was going through, it was sort of late 90s, early aughts, so they were trying to get the Olympics, they were doing a lot of urban renewal, knocking down these old courtyard houses, and the economy was booming, and people were just, the whole city was undergoing this cataclysmic change. So really the book was about how people were adjusting to this change and me wanting to document this moment in Beijing that was so incredibly exciting and terrifying for everyone who was living there. So it's also kind of a dual thing. It's a coming image of me, but also the city. So let's say a little background. My parents left in 1949 when the communists took over. My dad was a nationalist, his family were nationalists, and my mom, they were business people. And they met in New York, and then they moved to Maryland, where I was raised. And I was always very fascinated by China, and they said during the 80s while I was growing up that we would go back when I was 13. But I was 13 in 1989, so after the Tiananmen Square massacre, they just never talked again about going back. But I always, you know, I always had this somewhat, in the back of my mind, this desire to go there. So I'm going to read a little bit just of, the first chapter is just like a really quick background of where I come from, my upbringing. So I'll just read a little bit of about my family. Okay. It was during my teenage years that my relationship with my parents fell apart. I found the hermetically sealed environment of our suburban home suffocating, my go-go Chinese-American lifestyle of nonstop studying unbearable, my parents ceaselessly dictatorial. The community I'd grown up in was stifling. Everyone knew whose children went to Harvard and whose got pregnant, whose families were getting ahead in America, and whose were falling behind. My successes and failures were theirs as well, and nothing was ever enough for them. It turned out that we could be anything we wanted to be in life, as long as it was a doctor or a lawyer. My older brother followed all the rules. He got into an Ivy League college and would go on to be a lawyer, support Republican tax cuts, and never date. For a while, I copied him exactly. I earned my black belt, attended a math and science magnet school, became the editor of my high school newspaper. Though I mimed the right actions, my heart wasn't in it. All I knew was the simple urge to do the opposite of what I was supposed to do. Date white boys, talk nonstop on the phone, agitate for a driver's license. I idolized Georgia O'Keeffe and had a crush on Andre Agassi, and I imagined myself their love child. an ascetic, passionate being, trying to break free from the repression of the East Coast and a world where deals were made on the tennis court. Just, my parents wanted me to play tennis because they said that's where all the real deals in America get made, are on the tennis court, so they wanted me to play tennis. Okay. When I dated a boy who resembled, in my mom's eyes, a Hispanic drug dealer, and whose radical leftist parents were getting a divorce because their open marriage was falling apart, my mom routinely hung up on him when he called our house, rifled through my journals seeking dirt, and once delivered a succinct four-word safe sex talk to me: don't ruin your life. My parents sensed me going my own way, and instead of loosening their grasp, they tightened it. The drug dealer had actually been a straight-A student who eventually went to Harvard, though my mom had accurately sniffed out his beliefs in wanton drug use, free love, and Marxism. After my parents caught me alone at his house, something snapped in our relationship. Being Chinese was obviously the root of my problems, and so I began to hate all things Chinese, or what I imagined to be Chinese. I went off to a liberal arts college where I became a leftist, a feminist, and a vegetarian, shaved my head, and veered off the doctor-lawyer trajectory into English and women's studies. My parents insisted I go to the number one ranked liberal arts college instead of to my first choice, Oberlin, ranked 20 down from 14, which my dad likened to marrying an alcoholic and going on a honeymoon on a sinking ship. While I was away at college, he frequently sent me photocopies of Ann Landers columns that he found relevant to my life. One letter in particular I remember came from a dad who wrote in wondering how to deal with his daughter, whom he characterized as very smart but with no common sense. No common sense my dad had highlighted in yellow and underlined twice in red. I, too, was an avid Ann Landers reader, and my personal favorite column came from a young Asian American woman who wrote in wondering how to deal with her parents, who kept her under virtual house arrest. The letter had been signed oppressed, repressed, and depressed. I clipped it out and taped it into my journal. All right, so that's the world I come from. That's high school. Let's fast forward to college. So I decided I want to go to some exotic place to kind of look for what's missing in my life. So I go to Sweden, of course, in my junior year of college, obviously. So I wanted to take a break from the manicured New Englandness of Williams College, but to my dismay, found it even cleaner, colder, darker, and more orderly than the places I'd come from. The alienation I felt from my family seemed to extend to the rest of humanity, and I spent most of my time watching films alone. So I went to see this one film called Beijing Bastards because I'd deciphered in its description the words, and I'm sorry if there's any Swedish speakers here, Kinesis Rockhjärna, Chinese rock star. So I just was reading the descriptions, like Chinese rock star, I'm there. So it was this movie that had no plot, and it was about these guys in Beijing who just like get drunk and amble around, and like so they gotta go pregnant, and there's just nothing happens in it at all. And I was like, I love this movie, right? So the film opened an escape hatch into the world mirror opposite of the version of China I'd grown up in, where we were all nerdy, overachieving droids with no errant desires of our own, who lived out the script as it had been handed to us, marching through the Ivy Leagues into respectable professional careers. I had rarely put any thought into what contemporary China was like, and when I did, it took a huge mental leap to imagine the farmers and petty bureaucrats of my supposed motherland. Even my own relatives seemed impossibly foreign. But to my surprise, I recognized myself in those characters on screen, and through them, the filmmaker who had created them. I was young and alienated too, also drifting without narrative. And like the filmmaker, I just wanted to find a way to get the moment down on paper, by writing, by filming, by any means necessary. Back in the States, I stumbled across an article about the sixth generation of filmmakers in China who shot these gritty underground films in Beijing, including the director of Beijing Bastards, Zhang Yuan. The filmmakers had even written a manifesto that declared their aim to present a more truthful and more expansive document on the life of the Chinese people. And after making Beijing Bastards, Zhang Yuan was labeled a disseminator of spiritual pollution, and the government banned him from making any more films. So he made them all underground, and they only screen in Europe and that kind of thing. Okay, so that is where I came from. And at the end of college, I was like, what am I supposed to do now, right? I don't wanna follow that script, I gotta do something. And so around this time I read Things, the novel by George Perec. Has anyone read that? It's very good. It changed my life. is about a young couple who that decamps from their blissful life in Paris and moves to Sfax, an obscure seaside city in Tunisia, because, as I carefully copied into my journal, because Paris had become a shrunken universe, a world running out of steam, opening onto nothing. It was exactly how I saw life in New York unfolding if I moved there. That was my other plan, like move to New York. Puns, boozing, walks in the woods, dinner parties, endless discussions about films, plans, gossip, had long stood in for adventure, history, and truth. Adventure, history, and truth. I liked the sound of that. Suddenly, I knew beyond a doubt what I was meant to do. Go to Beijing, find the filmmakers, and make a documentary about them, right? I wanted to kick my nerdy upbringing to the curb and chase that vision of myself that had flitted across the screen in Beijing Bastards. Imagine the street cred I'd have if it worked out. This wasn't a plan that anyone with any common sense would have hatched. Luckily, I had none. So I end up there. So I move there and I get a job at an English language magazine as an editor. And I don't know anything about anything, basically. So, and I don't have anywhere to live. So I live with my grandmother. My paternal grandmother is from Beijing, and she has all these relatives who are still there. So I ask them if I can live with them. And so they live in this courtyard house in the middle of the old city, which sounds very romantic. You've probably seen like the news stories of these courtyard houses. But this house had no flush toilet and no hot water, no shower. So I was living there, like living on a cot in the middle of the living room with them for a month. And so they were just like doing a running commentary on everything I did. So they had never had an American cousin living with them. And they're just like commenting on every single thing and watching me commenting and reporting back to my family in the States about all the things I'm doing. So I'm living with them for a few weeks. And so it's my dad's cousin and then his son and daughter-in-law are also living there. So it's pretty oppressive. I will not read the oppressive parts, but they're pretty funny as well. So Xiaopeng is my the cousin's son, who is a little bit older than me. I'm like 22, and he's like 28 or something. Okay. On Saturday, Xiaopeng asked me if I wanted to ride bikes to Tiananmen Square. We'd been sitting around doing what Chinese families do so well together. Absolutely nothing. He'd asked in an offhand way, as if half expecting me to say no. My ears perked up like a dog's at the jingle of a leash. So basically, they never wanted me to leave the house. They were like, you can't leave the house. You can't go out. Like, what if something happens to you? What are we gonna tell your grandmother? So I was like always in the house and being surveilled. Okay, so he's asked me to go out to ride bikes at Tiananmen Square. It's like the best day of my life. I said, trying to act nonchalant. His question surprised me. Xiaopeng and I had been watching each other since I moved in. He reminded me of a character from Beijing Bastards. As far as I could see, he didn't drink or swear or go to rock concerts, but there was something about him reminiscent of the hooligans in the film, the same untouchably bored air, the same monosyllabic responses dropped from the corner of his mouth, the same inability to find value in anything. I wondered what Xiaopeng saw when he looked at me, yet another American cousin coming to teach English, learn Chinese, find her roots, and then leave. There had been others in my family before me, and I wanted to tell him that I was different. The whole point of moving far away from home was to leave my past behind and do the things I somehow couldn't at home, write, make movies, preferably a novel that would be an instant cult classic among the downtown cognoscenti, and or a gritty lo-fi documentary that would make me the darling of the indie film world. These were fragile, vaguely embarrassing dreams, never to be spoken aloud lest their spell be broken. I can't believe I always make myself read that because it's still so embarrassing. Okay, Xiaopeng biked swiftly through the hutongs and I wobbled along behind him. The traffic was chaotic. Bikes went the wrong way, swerved without notice, crossed in front of honking cars with inches to spare. Carts piled high with cabbages or pineapples careened by at full tilt. Nothing shielded me from the chaos around me. When I tested the brakes, they shuddered loudly, but barely slowed the flying pigeon bicycle. Xiaopeng never hit the brakes, and I scurried after him like a cat following a ball of yarn as it unraveled. If I lost him, the hutongs are the old alleys in Beijing, and they don't have signs, and they're just impossible to navigate. If I lost him, the hutongs would collapse into short bits of string, all looking about the same, none leading anywhere. Suddenly, we turned onto the Avenue of Eternal Peace. The avenue was wide and flat as an airport runway, and I felt ejected from my private world into the bright light of day. Xiaopeng and I rode side by side in the wide bike lane, in a flotilla of other bikes, the air cool against our faces. Beijing was in the heart of its most beautiful season, autumn, when the city appears exactly as it does in my dreams, glowing with grainy golden light, crisp with a faint tang of coal soot in the air. The closer we got to the square, the more orderly the traffic became, as if we were entering the government's fantasy of how life in the country was supposed to run. Soldiers in olive uniforms stationed at intervals told us where to go and where not to. Dusk was approaching, and we arrived at the square just as it was emptying of people. Only a few lingered to pose and take pictures. Tiananmen Square is one of the largest squares in the world and is flanked by immense buildings. The Great Hall of the People to the west, the Museum of the Chinese Revolution to the east, and Mao's mausoleum to the south. So much had happened here. I had seen the pictures. Mao waving from the rostrum of the Tiananmen Gate in 1949, girls screaming and waving little red books during the Cultural Revolution, students, democracy protesters camping out in the square in 1989. A place this big begged for grand, heroic, delusional gestures. Xiaopeng and I glided across the smooth surface, and I felt a rush of pleasure. I was released from myself, reduced to a simple and happy character in a corny patriotic play. He told me it was illegal to ride bikes on the square. We were breaking the law together. I felt almost close to him. We rode up to the flagpole at the north end of the square, where a crowd was pressing against the white railing that separated the square from the Avenue of Eternal Peace. Across the avenue was Tiananmen Gate hung with Mao's portrait. Traffic had been stopped in both directions on the broad avenue, and the scene was hushed with expectation. We hurriedly joined the crowd like extras late for a take, and we waited. What are we waiting for, I finally asked. Flag lowering ceremony, said Xiaopeng. Can you see? Not really. There are too many people. These people are not Beijingers, said Xiaopeng, his eyes flicking languidly over the crowd. I got it. Beijingers were too cool to hang out in Tiananmen Square. I saw the red flag with the yellow stars going down, and then the crowd straining to see. Xiaopeng held my bike steady and told me to stand on the frame, and I realized then that he had brought me here especially to see the ceremony, which happened every day at sunset. I saw glimpses of olive-clad soldiers saluting and then goose-stepping their way across the avenue, their boots clacking in perfect unison. They marched the flag under Mao and into the Forbidden City to rest until sunrise the next day, when the ritual would happen in reverse. The crowd was still and silent, and I shared their sense of awe tinged with fear. Once the soldiers disappeared from view, the lights changed to green, and with a single crisp arm movement from the soldier on the traffic mound, cars began moving again and the crowd broke apart. The magic moment was over. We returned to our private concerns, where to go next, what to eat for dinner. Xiaopeng and I rode back down the avenue, returning home. He took a sudden turn into the alleyways. Don't you ever get lost in these hutongs, I asked. No, I know all of Beijing's hutongs by heart, he said. He casually mentioned having been enrolled in Beijing Film Academy. My ears pricked up, and I asked if he knew any young underground filmmakers. He nodded. Really? You know them? I asked. I said their names like an incantation. Zhang Yuan, Wenguang, Shijian. Was he actually one of them? Did he just sell air conditioners to make ends meet? Yes, they were my classmates at the Film Academy. That made sense. They did all seem like versions of the same person, someone who had come of age in the heady 1980s. A time of idealism when China was opening to the world. That came to a brutal end with the Tiananmen Square massacre in 1989. That was when they all had gotten so cynical. I really want to meet them, I said. Can you introduce me? Sure, he said. Let's see. Just as I'd planned, I could just document the filmmakers while I lived here. It seemed my cousin was going to lead me straight to them. Things were suddenly marvelous. I was biking through the hutongs with my cousin, talking about meeting underground filmmakers. We understood each other better than our parents ever could. Crucial puzzle pieces seemed to be falling effortlessly into place. Over the next few weeks, I kept dropping hints that I wanted to go meet his filmmaker friends. He was always evasive.
One of the things that I was especially interested in, Val, is this idea that this trip was an act of rebellion. You know, that you, in sort of counterintuitively, going back to your parents' roots, which I think maybe in some other families, it's like, this is great. For in your family, this was an act of rebellion. And I had read somewhere in one of, I think, an interview you did that initially you didn't want to really write about your family in this story. And that's right. Such a challenge, I think, for any of us who have stories we want to tell or have stories we're working on telling, is how to write about the people that we love so much that are still in our life in a way that is honest and compelling, you know, without getting them upset. And so I just wondered, since, you know, you do come from this very, this background of like being dutiful in a way, being this good girl and making good grades, how you're able to reconcile that in writing Beijing Bastard.
I guess I was, from high school, I was always the rebellious one. I mean, I kind of did the right things, but they could tell I didn't want to be doing them. And so it was just years of me not doing what they wanted me to do, in sort of in escalating sort of increments. And I think going to China was like the ultimate, like, we really don't want you to go there. And I didn't read the part where they're like, you're going to hate it there. Why are you going there? You're ruining your life. And they call me like every month and like, do not, you know, come home. When are you coming home? And so I feel like that part wasn't as hard. I think what was hard was actually putting them into the story, putting the story of reconciliation into the book. Because I feel like I came at the book as a book of rebellion, as a book of, this is my coming of age. This is my sort of, you know, I go to a foreign country, young American goes to a foreign country, finds herself. And that was sort of the model that I had was working on. And as I was writing it, like, all of the stories and everything I was interested in had to do with family. And I kind of get involved. I start making this documentary about the speaking opera family. And, you know, I slowly began realizing there's something about my family that is driving me to write about them and experience them, and really having to come to connecting back with my family through the writing of it. And that was, like, actually the harder part for me was, like, being good again, because I was like, thought of myself, I'm like, I'm bad, I'm just bad to the bone. And I was like, no, you're also like, you want to be connected to them, you want to have this, have them understand you, you want to understand them too. So
were you scared about them reading the book? Did you share any sections with them before it was published?
I did not share any. I just felt like I couldn't. But I did tell them, I told them a lot about what was going to be, and I said, I'm going to dredge up all that stuff from high school, like all the really bad stuff, all the fights we got in. I'm gonna have to dredge that up. And then, like, there's a happy ending, so if you keep reading, like, it's like it gets a lot better at the end. So I was really scared of them reading it. I was actually really, really scared. And my mom really loved it, so I was like, I just felt so relieved when she said that.
And in your reading, you were talking about, you know, the inspiration for the title Beijing Bastard was this particular movie. Right, that was this very gritty, and you sort of saw a version of yourself in that. Did your parents know about that movie, or was that kind of through seeing that movie your sort of window into like a bad Val Wang is possible?
Yeah, I think that was one of the things that kind of like opened the door to me being like, okay, I'm gonna be bad. I'm really gonna own that, you know, I'm gonna go do this thing that symbolizes what I'm really not supposed to do. And they knew nothing. I mean, I think a lot of Chinese American kids have that, like, we have a double life, you know, you're the life you live with your parents, and then like just a secret life. You don't share anything with them, and you have these things that you're interested in, you just do not share with them. And so that was like a natural part of my growing up, just to keep these huge secrets from them.
Wow.
So yeah, and when I tell people, they're like, that's horrifying. And in my book, I interview this writer, this young Chinese writer who has quit her job, and she pretends she's going to the office. She goes to this little writing space. I don't know where she gets her money from, but she goes to this little writing space and she writes these novels. And then she goes home at 5, and her parents didn't know she was writing. She didn't know she'd quit her job. Nothing. I was like, oh my goodness, that's crazy. And I was like, oh, I do the exact same thing. And I was like, so yeah, it was funny to see people, but like even more extreme examples of that in China, like meeting people who had the same kind of relationships as I had with my parents, and made me feel like, okay, I'm not so weird.
I wanted to ask you a question just about sort of the packaging and marketing of the book and your story. Because I feel like, and maybe you said it tonight, I've heard you say it before, where you didn't want this to be a story about a girl going back to her roots, you know. That. And I wondered if like when you were conceiving of it, if you were aware of like, well, here's a narrative that people typically hear or drawn to, or, you know, that's not what I want my book to be, or where you had to kind of push back against, you know, agents or editors along the way to say I have something different in mind, and why that is.
Oh, Yeah, I think I came to it. I mean, when I would tell people I was writing a memoir about time in China, people would just automatically say, oh, did you go there to return to your roots? Did you find your, you know, that was just like the first thing everybody would say to me. And I'd be like, no, that's not it. I did not find my roots. I didn't, you know, and it took years to be like, okay, I did connect with my heritage. Yes, I did. But I think from the responses I got, even when I started writing it, you know, teachers even were like, is this about you discovering your identity? It's like, no, it's like me, young American, like confused, drifting without narrative, just trying to find myself. And so I think from the very beginning, it was just like, not like comments that I got from just casual people were kind of formulated that. But then that got kind of too solidified, and I kind of ended up breaking that up a little bit as the process went on.
I had another question, which I wonder if, you know, you were in Beijing for 5 years.
Yeah.
I wondered, you know, when you first moved there, did you have in mind, I'm going to write a book about this?
Like,
was that part of your conception? Or at what point in your living were you thinking of it as a story in a way?
Like, right. I think when I moved there, I didn't even admit that I wanted to be a writer. I think it was easier for me to say, I want to make films. I think writing is just seems so much more personal, and it seems so much more difficult for me to say I wanted to be a writer. And actually, the first time I said it was the month I was living with my relatives. And we owned all these different courtyard houses, and they were being destroyed by the city. At that point, it was like late 90s, and my grandmother had one. And I went to the rubble of one of these houses after it had been knocked down, and I was like, somebody has to tell this story. Somebody has to tell this. And I think that was the first time I really even said, like, I want to be a writer. So, and I was just a very inveterate note taker, and I just took tons of notes for no reason. And so when I came back, I had a lot of notes and a lot of videotapes and stuff. But it was never an idea when I went really to do it.
Was it easier for you to approach this book saying, okay, this isn't just a story about me, you know, Val Wang is a story about China at this time and sort of what happened to these people? Like, were you, you know, was that in your mind? Because I feel like that in a way is you know, that's something that a memoirist can struggle with, is like, oh, this is such a narcissistic endeavor and it's about me, when, you know, it doesn't have to be.
Right. Yeah, I mean, I was a journalist when I was there, so my instinct really is to write about other people and to be interested in other people's stories. I'm kind of the big backdrop of social change, economic change, historical change. Like, that's kind of my instinct. And so I always wanted to write about other people, and that was a struggle, actually, in writing the memoir, to put myself into it and put my family story into it, put more of my emotions into it, and, like, I really wanted to be very invisible. So the first draft was, like, all the same stories, but not... I wasn't really in it. You didn't, like, that whole first chapter where I'm just like taking you through my high school days was not in the book. It just starts and you're in Beijing. You're like, who is this narrator? Everyone's like, we don't know who you are. I'm like, you can guess, you know, Val Wang. I mean, come on. And then you're like, no, you really have to, like, lay it out and say who you are, where you've been, and where you come from. And so that was actually much more of a struggle for me than doing the stories about other people and the story about Beijing changing. That was, like, really the motivation, was to capture Beijing. Not my own. I just felt embarrassed. Like, I mean, my story is so small compared to all these, like, 1 billion people, 1 billion people who have these amazing stories, and, like, why am I writing about myself? But it seemed in a way like a bridge. Like, if you could connect to me, and through me, you could connect to people in China. That was my hope.
Maybe just repeat his question.
Okay. I was much younger when I was there. And have I been back? And what have I seen? And how does that impact my family narrative? Okay, yeah. So I left in 2002, and I've been back a number of times. And it's always a little shocking because the changes in Beijing are so drastic. Like, literally, neighborhoods will be gone. And I mean, even when I lived there, I would drive, like, not drive by neighborhood for 6 months, and it would be just gone. And so it's just always, like, shocking. For me, there was a lot of grief that went in that time where things were being destroyed, and I feel like part of writing the book was exhuming some of that grief and dealing with it and leaving something from that time. And so I think I went back in 2008. It's funny, it's the Olympics again. I went back for the Olympics, and it was really shocking. And horrible, and I was really sad. I just finished writing the book, but then I also felt like, okay, I really have to embrace this. I have to embrace the change, and so many people's lives are changing, and they're getting with it, and I have to get with it too. And the pace of life has changed a lot. It's a lot faster. And there's a lot more sort of materialism. There's a lot more disparity in wealth. All the great things we're seeing everywhere in the world, and environmental degradation. I mean, the development is just very helter-skelter. It's like very difficult to see in a lot of ways. So I'm still very, very interested in going. And my kids are now learning Mandarin. Like, I'm doing to them the thing that my parents did to me that I swore I would never do to them. But they're like in a Mandarin preschool. So yeah, they're learning Mandarin. Hopefully we're gonna go back next year and kind of continue. Because I feel like when I had kids, it was like, oh, it's not just me. It's like this whole like generation after generation of people who are connected and care about it. And I care very much about the country and how it develops and what happens there. So I want to pass that on to them.
The question is, what were the contradictions that you saw in terms of how your parents saw China and then how you saw China, if there were contradictions?
Right. Well, it's funny because they left when they were kids. They left when they were 5 and 8. And they grew up in Southeast Asia. My mom grew up in Burma. My dad grew up in Indonesia. So their version of China was also this kind of diasporic version, where there was a kind of a nostalgia for this idealized version of China and for how you're supposed to be and these sort of moral codes. And they brought that with them to the States. And so it was a very outdated version of what China was like in terms of how you're supposed to act, and it's just the filial piety and the Confucian, everything. It was all very set, it like fossilized almost. And then I went back to China. It was chaotic. I mean, it was, everything was like turned upside down. There was like no morals, there were no codes. It was and for me it was like, oh, this is great, this is like fantastic, I love it here. But it was not the place that I had been like raised to think that I was gonna find, not the lack of morals was not good in other ways, obviously. But it was very exciting as a 20-something-year-old to be there.
The question is Mao Zedong still a revered public figure in modern China?
Among very much older people, but not the younger generation. No, I think people have kind of come to terms with some of the things that he did that were not good for the country. When I first went there in like the late 90s, young people, like college students, were still saying, oh, I want to join the Communist Party because that's how you get ahead in the world in China. And now that's not, it doesn't seem to be a part at all of what people think of how to get ahead in China.
I have a question, just in having to do with identity, since that's such a big theme in your book. And I think that someone who might have considered a trip like this, especially moving to a place as different as China, as Beijing, might only live there for a year. And you lived there for 5 years, and this was after COVID.
Right.
That's a significant amount of time to move to a country. And I just sort of wonder about, where. If it still feels like home to you in a way, or if it sort of feels like a home to, a version of yourself, like you didn't become a grown-up until you went there. And so it was sort of like your grown-up self wouldn't have been able to, in a way, be realized without that trip. I just sort of wonder how your relationship continues with Beijing and China in that way.
Yeah, I mean, I definitely feel like I became who I was there, and a lot of my core of who I am was really formed there. So I do have this very, I don't know if sentimental is the right word, but very, very deep connection and like abiding affection for it. And I go back and it feels like home in a lot of ways. I mean, I still have family there, I still have friends there, and it just feels really familiar, even as it's totally, like, parts of it are just totally different. And it does feel like home, and I feel like I miss it when I'm not there. And when I'm there, I miss it here. It's just, the fate of my family, I guess. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Was there a subconscious desire to go back to my family? And even though it was an act of rebellion, was there a desire to sort of contact my family? Yeah, I definitely think there was, and I definitely like had this curiosity about China. I just feel like there were so many unanswered questions. You know, I grew up in the suburbs. It couldn't have been more placid and boring. But my parents would tell me these amazing stories of these places, and we would watch, like, and this is in the book, like National Geographic specials, and there was one where there was like a monkey, like a roadside stand, there's like a monkey with its head in a vise, and they crack it open, they like eat the brains out. I was like, this is where we're from, like this is crazy, you know. And there's like just this fascination with it, and so I always did have this kind of pull. Like I want, there was just some questions that are going to be answered if I go there. And there were, I mean, but not the questions I thought were going to be answered, different ones. So I'm going to, I'll read another, but now my kids are going to read the dirty part. Okay, let's see. Okay. This is the late 90s. I fished my a little small black beeper out of my bag, and I called the unknown number, asking the man who'd answered if he'd beep 16386. I was impatient as the magazine had to be put to bed that night. So I was working on this English language magazine. And I did like editing and writing and copy editing and graphic design there. So Wang Zhenluo, that's my Chinese name. The voice was deep and loud and jagged, as if the man's windpipe had been removed and replaced with an industrial-grade rock polisher. Wen Guang, I said, how are you? Still alive, he said. Wen Guang was another of the sixth-generation documentary filmmakers I'd read about long ago and in hope to meet. Xiao Ding had introduced us, and Wu called me occasionally to get help with translations or just to check up on me. He seemed to like me because I was young and idealistic and wanted to write and make documentaries that told the unvarnished truth about China once I figured out what that was. What are you doing right now? I'm at work, I said, cringing slightly, knowing what was coming next. You're still at that job? Why are you wasting your time with a full-time job? How do you expect to make a documentary if you spend all day nailed to an office working on someone else's project, he growled. I could picture him on the other end of the line. Small glasses, bony angular face, wispy facial hair, looking exactly the part of an old wise man who has retreated to a mountain to regard society from afar. He was only in his 40s, but I was young, and to me he seemed ancient and full of wisdom. I swore I could smell cigarette smoke drifting through the phone line. Let's see. What are you working on? I asked Wu, hoping to draw fire away from me. I just finished traveling around the countryside shooting a documentary called Jianghu, Life on the Road, he said. I shot a group of traveling opera performers who live a Jianghu lifestyle. The tradition is almost dead and I wanted to document it, so I traveled with the troupe for months, shooting hundreds of hours of footage. Actually, that's why I called you today, he said. I'm doing the subtitles and I need your help translating one of the folk songs. It's an exceptionally dirty song and my translator is a nice Chinese girl who is too much of a prude to translate properly. Plus, to make everything harder, the government has censored many of the dirtiest characters from the dictionary, and I have to make them by hand on my computer. These country people have such a rich vocabulary of dirty words, and the government wants to choke it to death. They want to control how we think and feel. Can you believe how disgusting they are? Mm-hmm, I said, fiddling with the magazine layout on the computer. I can help you translate it. Just fax the song to me. Actually, that won't work, he said. It's in a local dialect, and I'll have to explain it to you. Plus, it has to go to a festival tomorrow. Do you have time to translate it right now? Why not? And you're not a prude, are you? It's crucial that I get a really dirty translation. If you're not comfortable, I don't know why I always make myself read this. If you're not comfortable doing this, just say so. I looked over at, there's a crowd gathering. I looked over at my coworkers tapping away on their computers. No, I'm not a prude. Translating was a painstaking process. He read the song to me line by line, first in their local dialect with the obscure slang, then translated into Mandarin, obscured by his thick accent. He explained the dirty parts and repeated it slowly to make sure I had understood him. I then repeated the lines aloud in Chinese. Saying dirty words in Chinese was just like saying any other words to me, but the sound of them made my coworkers look up in alarm. I then read Wu back my English translations. Roll over and stick it in, I whispered, suddenly shy. What was that last part? I cut my hand over the mouthpiece and scrunched down behind my computer screen, glancing nervously at my coworkers, who were now as oblivious to the dirty English as I had been to the Chinese. I enunciated loudly and carefully, stick it in. What? Stick it in, I said, blushing. S-T-I-C-K, it, in. Are you sure it's dirty enough, he asked. How about... How about roll over and stick your dick in? Your dick. D-I-C-K. That's better, he said. Okay, read me back what you have, I said. Roll over and stick your dick in. Deep, I said. Add deep at the end. D-E-E-P. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
What works well for me is to do a lot of research and then give myself time to forget it, so that by the time I sit down to write, I have a vague idea that I know this, but I don't know from where. I don't know where I'm drawing this fact from. So it does seem like something that belongs to me rather than just using research.